facial perception. To me, it's the ability to sense or feel on my skin, my face, that there is a volume, an obstacle, that's in my way. There's a reason why I feel this way. Everybody else that does is that the density of the air is different. So you sense, you know, from your face that, oh, there's something coming off. You better not eat it. So you slow down. Find out what it is. Now, I'm not as good as some of that. I have some friends, blind like me, who really can sense a wall like easily, oh, 8 feet away. And they'll say, oh, there's a wall over there.
Thank you.
terribly important. But at the same time, I really don't have too much of a sense, a need, that I have to feel a face or feel a body to know what they're like. It's just never been that interested in. I guess people to me, from the time of my blindness, became less physical and more abstract. Maybe I'm wrong, but the way I see it, in a dream, you'll sense that presence is there. And you'll know perfectly well it's your wife, or Teddy, or someone else. But you really have not seen these very definite features. Is that correct? Is that what happens in a dream with sighted people? That's what happens to me. What happens to me now? And this is a bit the way I see people around me. They're terribly important entities. But the physical just doesn't come into it too much. Isn't that odd?
canvases. One sat as a figure sits or walks or leans. A saint,
an angel.
Every canvas means the same one meaning, neither more nor less. He feeds upon her face by day and night. And she with two kind eyes looks back on him. Fair as the moon and joyous as the light. Not well with waiting, not with sorrow dim.
Not as she was when hope shone bright.
Not as she fills his dream.
The letters were in the attic. I don't know what drew me up there on a day that could have been used for checking the gutters or mending the fences. My late aunt had let the place drop into partial ruin in the decade before her death. Nonetheless, up in the attic I was, sorting through boxes of old and broken toys, moth-eaten dinner jackets, yellow bank statements, nameless daguerreotypes, and finally, the letters, neatly stacked in an unmarked trunk. There were 20 packets, one for each year, from 1850 to 1870, tied with a faded blue silk ribbon. Love letters, I thought at once. I took them downstairs to the library, the only room that didn't suffer from a leak or crumbling plaster or creeping mildew, and went on with the day's chores. It was evening, and cold was sifting through the windows when I sat down at the writing desk to look at them. The first two wore no headings, but the third was addressed, quite clearly, to Dante Gabriello Rossetti, Cheyne Walk, London. I admit that my first reaction was mercenary. A brief and hopeful vision of large cash sales and mended roofs. It hardly seemed possible that I could have stumbled upon the correspondence of one of the 19th century's most famous artists and poets. But I flipped through the pages with agitated interest. All were in the same spiky, antiquated hand. The earliest was a thank you note for a volume of Tennyson, continuing,
I would not want to sit in a picture of Dante and Beatrice in the Garden of Eden, since, as I said, I appear in your eyes to be Beatrice exactly. How odd to find your Beatrice in a plain English girl who must bring flowers and bonnet. But it is the wonder of the artist to find the poet in the plain. And I am glad to see you. This Tuesday coming will be what I have been telling, as Mondays and Wednesdays I am glad to Mr. Tosa.
The next, thank Rossetti for
helpful words and encouragement about my designs. Though I do find it all extravagant in your praise, surely no genius I. But I know you to be a person of tremendous enthusiasm. And if you will be enthusiastic about my drawings, I will only be happy.
Quickly, the letters became more intimate. Love letters that bounced between the romantic pronouncements and discussions of art. One, dated Hastings, April 20th, 1860, read,
oh, Gabriel, I hope you will not regret having such a crazy, poetic, artistic wife, rather than a sweet angel with her hands always deep in a suet pudding instead of deep in a pinch of water.
But no marriage appeared to take place, for the letters continued to detail a life apart. One described a photography session in Oxford.
All quite mysterious, and as much unlike the quiet pastime of sketching as could be. But the product is the picture you find enclosed. My own face, promoted by some chemical genius to his plate. So I know that I am really here, a true person, taking up space in the garden of Oxfordshire, and not just the creature of your own poetic imagination. I may not seem so beautiful in the photograph as I seem when you're by your hand, but I am perhaps more truly as I am. It is the difference between us, I think. I should always prefer truth to beauty, for you would pick the other way around.
to year, blue ribbons packet to blue ribbons packet, the spirit of the letters degenerated.
Why did ever you ask me to marry you, to preserve me, like your beloved Beatrice, chaste and inaccessible in that tower of want, condemned to a death in life, not even to death itself, its blessed release and rest. But no, the great Dante must be sacred even there. She only lives for him to look at.
Romance gave way to complaints and failing health.
But now, I have not the strength or interest to take you to task. Your life is your own, and I am beyond caring what you do, or am too weak to care very deeply. My life is now my own as well, though I shall not perhaps take burden from it much longer. At least I leave behind a record of your passage in a last strange odyssey, you and I. I am not so vain to think that my little drawings and poems are of any importance to you. But they, like photographs, like these letters, will continue on in the world to show it I lived. And for that I am to some degree indebted to you.
But then, at last, there was a reference to a marriage, and a few months later, a pregnancy.
Just imagine some tiny sweet creature crowned with red gold hair and your two sooty smudges staring out for eyes. What a monster she shall be. The finches will flutter over her and the puppies will lick her dear little toes. And I shall waddle about quite the respectable little mama and you will pretend so very hard to be the stern papa. And what a grand old joke it will be.
But something must have gone wrong. A letter dated February 10th, 1862, read,
I am too weary to continue, and there is no reason to. Now you will be free to love Beatrice, and I will be free to rest. I have no more love in me. Unless Anna Mary is right, I am to see once again my dear sweet baby. This time within paradise. I ask of you only two things, that you look after my brother for me, and that you do not lie about me. I was never Beatrice. I was a wholly unremarkable girl, with a small gift of drawing, who loved you once.
After this, the letters changed, becoming fragmentary, incomplete, as if written in fits and starts from an insurmountable distance. An asylum, perhaps. They were not happy letters.
It is fine here and quiet. There is greater power in silence than in all your fine words, so I would wish to be silent. You have taken away everything you ever gave me. Cannot you leave me alone?
Another read.
You ask if I forgive you. From here the question doesn't mean much, one way or the other. Why should I not give you the answer you desire?
But no answer was given. The last read simply,
I do not want to haunt you. I do not want to haunt you. I do not want to haunt you. Once again, you have exhausted me.
I retied the ribbon and sat for a long time, looking out at the gloaming, at the crumbling walls of my estate, at the moldering and unkempt bushes. The next day, I rang an old friend in London, now in the manuscripts and autographs department of a large auction house. He didn't skip a beat.
I don't.
Come, Gabriel.
Why not?
Because Rossetti's correspondence was carefully assembled and edited by his brother at the time of his death. And while he did marry his model, Lizzie Siddle, he destroyed all of her letters after her death. But you know, these kind of things crop up every now and again. The whole Rossetti coffin thing attracts a lot of awards.
Wait a second. What whole Rossetti coffin thing?
The poems. In Barrett's poems, the only thing I can't be in her coffin when she died, a kind of sacrifice. But he couldn't live with it, so he had her dug out to retrieve her. Romantic, ghoulish style.
When did she die?
Sometime in the 60s.
There was a pause, and I could hear the flipping of pages.
Here it is, 1862, February 11, 1862.
The day after the last normal letter.
What?
Nothing.
Anyway, I don't know what it is you've got, but they write letters for Lizzie.
But here, the conversation was cut off by a scream of static, and then dead silence. It took me 2 days to locate the fault in one of the wires coming into the house, which appeared to have been melted through. That conversation should have made an end of my fascination with the found letters. They could not be what they seemed to be, the full correspondence of Lizzie Sibyl and Dante Gabriel Rossetti. They must be the remains of some long-forgotten hoax. But that didn't make sense either. Lizzie hadn't entered an asylum in 1862. She died. So why did the letters, fraudulent or not, continue for 8 more years? I ordered some books on Rossetti from a London bookseller, a biography, a volume of his letters, a collection of his poems. I opened the biography first, or rather, I should say, opened itself. The spine appeared to have been cracked at page 135. And the book fell open to the page describing Lizzie's death by an overdose of laudanum, Rossetti's theatrical grief, and the burial of his poems in her coffin. It also mentioned that, in addition to destroying her letters, he destroyed all the photographs of her he could find. He preserved her poems and her drawings, though he never sought to have them published. All that remained were artistic visions of her, mainly his. Later, the book told of how in 1869 Rossetti hired a friend to unearth the coffin and retrieve the poems, only to be racked by guilt, knowing that the truth must ooze out in time. The truth is, he wrote, no one so much as herself would have approved my doing this. Art was the only thing for which she felt seriously. Had it been possible to her, I should have found the book on my pillow the night she was buried. After reading this, I went to bed, but I didn't sleep well. In the hours, my restless dreams were finally shattered by the ear-cracking shriek of a smoke alarm going off in one of the ground floor rooms. I raced downstairs, expecting curtains ablaze, but could find nothing amiss. It was only the next morning that I noticed a pile of ash on the writing desk where the book of Rossetti's letters had been. For the next few days, I kept busy with repairs and largely avoided the library, in part because there was more urgent work to be done, but also because a strange, musty odor had developed there, and I dreaded the discovery of another rotting timber or animal carcass in the wainscot. When, however, the smell began to seep into the hall and kitchen, I armed myself with rubber gloves and a bucket of disinfectant and prepared for battle. The smell was coming from the writing desk, where I now saw the book of Rossetti's poems had turned greenish and pubescent, and through its center was a large, round wormhole. When I picked it up, the book crumbled into my hand in a shower of mold spores and unidentifiable crud. I threw it out. I did not bother to try to find rational explanations for these events. I knew instinctively I would find none. Another kind of situation was called for. Why do ghosts haunt? Common wisdom tells us it is to complete some unfinished business, to identify the murderer, to confess great guilt, to reveal lost treasure. So why had Lizzie come back, if it was Lizzie, if she had come? The interruption of her sleep, the disinterment of her corpse, that was public knowledge, hadn't been for 100 years. What was it that the letters revealed? so much as herself would have approved of my doing this. Art was the only thing for which she felt seriously. Had it been possible to her, I should have found a book on my pillow the night she was buried. I love Art. Was it Lizzie who cared so for Art? Rossetti had destroyed her letters, her photographs, her ordinary mortal flotsam. He had preserved her drawings, her poems, and above all, his own pictures and poems in which she is recreated, not as she is, but as she haunted his dreams. That, I finally realized, was the meaning of the letters, the ordinary mortal flotsam of the letters, the truth rather than the beauty, Lizzie rather than Beatrice. How the letters came back from the ashes, I do not know. Any more than I know how my telephone lines melted through, or how a book can burst into flames. I only know that this is true. That is why I'm telling you this now, to lay a spirit to rest. The house will be less interesting without her.
One face is split up from all his canvases. One surface he feels, sits, walks, feels. A sanity, a name, an angel. Every plan experiences what seems, neither more nor less.
Nor less.
Yet he keeps on her face by day and by night. And she with two kind eyes will take
it back on him.
Fair as the moon, as drawn choice as the night. Not well created, not destroyed, but she not as she is,
was when her hope shone bright,
not as she did, not as she wishes, but as she fills this room.
Court pause.
Yeah.
supposed to used to do.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.